What's up, everybody? CHM Carnivorous here. I hope you're having a wonderful day and a wonderful week. Now, if you'll remember two videos ago, we talked about what carnivorous plants are best to get rid of fungus gnats. Today, we're going to talk about another pest that doesn't necessarily affect plants, but it affects plant owners along with just about everybody else in the world. We're going to talk about how carnivorous plants play a role in getting rid of these very annoying pests and how adding them to your collection, adding them to your home, and just adding them to your life in general could help out significantly on reducing these pests. All that and more coming your way in just a minute. See you soon. So all of this is part of a series that I'm wanting to create about how we can integrate carnivorous plants into our lives. Whether you are a carnivorous plant grower, which I hope you are, or a non-carnivorous plant grower, these plants can have a place in your life. And if you're just not a plant collector in general, I highly suggest that you do because it will bring a lot of joy to your life. But if you're not, how these plants can serve a functional role is also important. Now, I've beaten around the bush enough. Today, we're going to talk about how carnivorous plants can help with mosquitoes. That's right, mosquitoes. Now, before I show you which plants would be the best enforcers for helping with this, there's an important distinction to make here. Mosquitoes aren't on the menu for carnivorous plants. Carnivorous plants don't produce any sort of pheromones or anything like that that would attract this species. Carnivorous plants developed what's called chitinase to break down the chitin or the shells in insects like beetles and ants. There's really not that going on for mosquitoes. However, they will get food where they can get food, and they will trap what they can trap. And so there are a few plants in the Druss class that are very good at helping with mosquitoes, and we're going to talk about three of them today, and I'm going to mention a fourth that is probably the best for doing so. But before we get to that, let's talk about Nepenthes and their role with potentially catching mosquitoes. There's a mixed bag here. Now, if mosquitoes fall into the traps, certainly the Nepenthes will eat it. But there's also mosquitoes who lay their larvae in Nepenthes. So it's a win-lose battle depending on what type of species you have. So they're really going to be out of the running altogether for helping out for that. And like I said, they don't really produce anything that's going to attract mosquitoes. So we're going to want something that's going to be able to catch them on accident, but be large enough to be able to capture quite a lot of them without having to draw them in with any sort of scent. Now, Sarracenia will certainly capture them if they happen to fall prey and to go into their little pitchers, but they themselves, again, aren't going to do a great job. Pinguicula will do a decent job if the mosquitoes happen to land near one of them, but they're really not that large. There are some pretty gigantea, which are going to be pretty big, but for the most part, they're not that large, so they're not going to capture a lot. Let's talk about the ones that will. And first up, I'm going to go ahead and take a quick break, get the plant, bring it back, and we'll talk about it. We'll see you soon. First up, we're going to talk about Druss capensis. Now, this is, believe it or not, going to be the smaller of the ones that are going to help you deal with mosquitoes. The good news about Druss capensis, though, is it produces a ton of seeds. And just like with fungus gnats, it will produce almost like a cluster, clumping behavior, just because of all the plants it grows from its roots, and also because it is so prolific at seeding that it will produce tons and tons of colonies of plants all around it. The problem with capensis is going to be the height. So you could have this in a communal area or somewhere around your plants that are more in sort of a watery kind of condition. While it will produce some defense against mosquitoes, it isn't the number one that is going to get you there. And so we're going to scale it up a little bit, and we're going to talk about the next one that's going to be more effective, but it's not the best effective. And then we're going to end which one would be the most advantageous to own. I happen to strongly suggest that you buy a Druss capensis because it is a beautiful plant and it is remarkable in its carnivory. But for this specific topic, we're going to look at something else. Next up, we have Druss filiformis. Now, these, depending on the type that you get, are going to be way more effective than a capensis, but not the most effective. Filiformis You have your Florida red over here that's going to say pretty dang small. So that's not going to be the best in your repertoire. You have the regular filiformis that's going to do a better job. But then you have things like Tracii, which is going to do a very good job because how tall it is, or a Florida giant, which gets leaves up to about 2 feet. Now, what's really cool about Florida giant and filiformis in general is they tend to clump. They grow from their roots, and they will do an excellent job of clustering, which giving you height to be able to assist with catching these pesky critters. Again, they're not looking to capture mosquitoes, but it does give you the height that you would need, and it gives you the clustering behavior. These happen to be newer, so they're very sparse, but in just a short period of time, this whole thing will be full of filiformis, especially with this one flowering. This is one of the few varieties that actually produce viable seeds. So let's talk about the probably second best, and then we'll talk about the first best in just a moment. The second best friend for catching mosquitoes are gonna be Drosera banata. Now, this happens to be a banata giant form, so it's gonna keep that T form, but it will get quite large. And if you hold it up with some sort of binding, it will get about 2, maybe 3, 3.5 feet tall, and it will cluster quite a bit. And so that will give you a good height advantage to sort of catch those mosquitoes flying around, and it will also produce a nice bush. The problem is it tends to stay more upright in bright light, or it will droop considerably in dull light. So getting it to be right in the sweet spot takes a little time and a little bit of patience. But it will do a good job of catching those mosquitoes once this is full. As you can see here, not gonna be very advantageous, but once this thing gets full and big, it will do an excellent job. Now, there are banatas that are much better than the T form. Something like a Multifida extrema, which can have up to 36 points on these leaves. So this has two, it can have up to 36 points. Normally they're about 12 points. There is Marston's Dragon, which is very similar to a staghorn, which is another giant form. So staghorn gets these absolutely beautiful dichotomous leaves where it can have up to, I think it's 6 or 7 points, but they get very, very large and very bushy. Marston's Dragon and the staghorn are gonna be very, very close as far as the way that they look, but they will act the same way. They get very, very full and they get very large. And so they can get between 2, 2.5 feet in diameter and about 2.5 feet tall. And so something like that could make a great defense against mosquitoes, especially if you have more than one. But now we're gonna talk about the number one plant for helping with mosquitoes. So as promised, let's talk about the number one plant. Now, I have a grower friend who has a lot of these, and he talks about just how many mosquitoes they catch. And that is Drosera banata, variegated variety dichotoma giant. This plant gets enormous. It is the largest by far of any Drosera. It can reach up to 4 feet wide by 4 feet tall, sometimes larger than that. Its leaves itself, its petioles, can get upwards of 2 feet long. This thing is a monster, monster plant. And if you mix this with other of those, you can get an entire bush almost of these plants. Now again, just like all the other carnivorous plants, they're not seeking out mosquitoes. However, they will gladly catch them out of the air. And so size and width, height, are your friends in this case. Putting these plants in with other bog conditions where you might have more of a watery area, just make sure it's in inert soil, can help out immensely. Putting it in a pot in sort of a communal area can also help. Certainly not gonna get rid of the problem, but it can definitely help, and you'll be feeding the plant along the way and feeling a little bit like you've gotten vengeance on these mosquitoes. So to wrap up this video, none of these plants themselves will capture all your mosquitoes. However, collecting them and grouping them together will provide a much larger and much more dense of defense for these critters. It may not take the entire problem away, but it will help cut down. And as far as I'm concerned, less mosquitoes is better. Another honorable mention that we didn't talk about in the video is Venus flytraps. They will capture mosquitoes and they will eat them. However, even with a large cluster of a plant, you're going to get few and far between. What we're looking for is size and stickiness, something that these mosquitoes are going to fly through and just get caught and then be done. I hope you've enjoyed this video. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns, please don't hesitate to leave a comment for me. By the way, we've hit 3,000 subscribers. Thank you so much for your support and continuing to drive this community. I am so very blessed to be able to have you as part of the community. As always, have a wonderful day and a wonderful week. I'll see you soon. Bye-bye.